Hello everyone, so my name is Efu and you are welcome to my world. On this channel, I make videos on my life here in China because I'm currently a PhD student here in China studying architecture. And in addition to that, I do videos on faith because I am a Christian and I believe in Jesus Christ. So if you think you would enjoy this kind of content, just feel free to join the family. In today's video, I want to talk about this man of God who just passed away. I know there are a lot of people who don't like him, but there are still a lot of people who love him and whose lives he has impacted. And that is T.B. Joshua. Perfect, T.B. Joshua. Okay. And in this video, I just want to talk about how I met him, or how I got to know about him, and why I loved him. If you are very close to me, if you are someone who is very close to me, you know that if you talk of men of God, right, like men of God in this world, in this current world, my favorite of them all was T.B. Joshua. So, actually, the first time I saw anything that has to do with him was in 2011. And before that, I had heard about him. I had in Ghana, right? The name T.B. Joshua was there, but it came with the notion that he was a fake prophet. If you heard T.B. Joshua when I was growing up, it came with he was a prophet, but a fake one. He was this, he was that. There was a lot of rumors. And so I think subconsciously, a lot of people grew up having that notion. Like personally, I grew up thinking I never really thought about it when I was growing up because I was not the type of person who even followed any other prophet apart from the pastors in my local church. I'm a Presbyterian, okay? So like I just didn't care about him or whatever he did, but I knew that he was a fake prophet. So the first time I saw his church was in my best friend's house in 2011. I had gone to visit my best friend, and they had DSTV at that time. So there was a deliverance session going on. It wasn't even him, okay? It was one of his men. No, okay? He was carrying out a deliverance session. And so my best friend drew my attention to it and was like, hey, this is T.B. Joshua's church, and this is one of his men doing this deliverance. In my head, I was like, really? Like, why should my best friend be watching such a thing? But I never voiced it out. In my mind, I remember thinking, why is Priscilla watching this? Like, why do they have this in their home? But I didn't voice it out, as I said earlier on. But I just watched a little and then I took my eyes off because I didn't want to be infected, or I didn't want to be possessed or something of that sort. I just didn't want to be close to that. And so that day passed, and then I went to the university. I think during the summer vacation of one semester in the university, I joined my church on evangelism project. We went to a village in Ghana to just talk to people about Jesus Christ. So there was this day that we went for a round of evangelism, came back home to rest, and then usually when we come back home, we meet for a short prayer. We pray for those we spoke to, that the Holy Spirit would touch their hearts and draw them closer to God. Okay, so we came back, and during one of those prayer meetings, I remember feeling very sad and depressed. I was really crying, and it was about my dad. In my mind, right, I was just thinking, I am here talking to people about Jesus Christ and here praying that people be saved, but my own father in my own house was still not saved. Like, it filled me with so much pain, like so much sorrow. I couldn't control myself. I never spoke to anyone about it, but I just kept crying. And then the leader who was leading the prayer session said, as we prayed, he said, there is one person here and you are very sad because a family member of yours is not saved. and you are just feeling like, really, what am I doing here? Like, you are so sad because of this. Like, you cannot even pray for these people. And then he went on to say that, don't worry, your dad will be saved. I knew that message was for me, and I even started crying more. I realized that whenever my dad called me, he was always talking about my spiritual life, asking me about how my walk with God was going. Like, all of a sudden he had interest in my spiritual life, and he would even encourage me, like telling me to take God seriously. And when I went home, I saw a drastic change in my father's life. My father had started reading the Bible. He has started praying. Like, I'm the most prayerful person in my house, always praying, always admonishing us to pray. He had accepted Jesus. She said there was a day that my dad joined her in the living room and started watching us more. So I was shocked because I had heard of this man. I knew he was a fake prophet. And so from time to time, when no one was around, I'll just quickly turn the TV station to Emmanuel TV. Like, I wanted to see what was going on there. I wanted to really know what was going on. And so I'll just turn it there. And then I started listening to his preachings. I started joining their live services. I believe in Jesus Christ. I have the Holy Spirit, and I know it when the Holy Spirit is talking to me. Like, I just knew that he was a man of God, and I kept watching, and I kept asking myself, so why was there that news, like that thing, that he was a fake man of God? I really couldn't understand. I just kept thinking about it. My favorite among his teachings were his teachings on forgiveness, because I struggled a lot at that time to forgive. Like, if someone hurt me, I would get so depressed, I would be so hurt, I would harbor the feeling in my heart. Like, I just did not understand why people should hurt people. Forgetting that sometimes I also hurt people, right? But I just couldn't comprehend why people should hurt me. Like, I could harbor hate, harbor bitterness, and then it affects my relationship with people. Like, if you do something to me, I won't even tell you, okay? I'll just cut you off. You might not even know why I've cut you off, but in my heart and physically everything, I have cut you off. I just couldn't forgive. But I believed in Jesus Christ. But I had not allowed Jesus Christ or the Holy Spirit to transform me. Okay? It was after I started watching Emmanuel TV that I saw the real need to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, that I started to work on myself. And I also saw the power of God work miracles through a man. And before that, whenever I slept or dreamt, I would see myself healing people, like touching people, and then Jesus Christ does the healing. Okay? I'll see myself casting out demons. I used to see myself doing all those things that I saw on Emmanuel TV, but out of fear or disbelief, I cannot explain how my life was at that time. I believed in Jesus Christ. I knew Jesus had died to save me, but I think it ended there for me. Like, I did not walk in the power that came with believing in Jesus Christ. I was not wholly committed to God. I cannot say I am wholly committed now, because there's still a lot of work to be done. But at that time, it was really just believing, going to church, following a routine, quiet time, quiet time session in the mornings. I it was just something I was doing, even though I really believed that I did not walk with power. I did not live with power. I did not walk in the victory that comes with believing in Jesus Christ. It was after I discovered Emmanuel TV that I started believing in the things that God could use me for, because I saw a fellow man, a man just like being used, and I just knew. He always said it, that it was because he had given himself to Jesus Christ, wholly given himself to Jesus Christ to be used. I knew that was the reason. And so I was motivated, I was encouraged. I remember there was a time my nephew, I have shared this testimony in church for my nephew who was 10 years old at that time, he fell and then he broke his teeth, the upper ones, and it was the permanent teeth, okay, not the milk teeth. So it means that he either had to go to a dentist to fix that teeth or live with broken teeth. It was very serious, like broken. Like, I don't have a picture of that teeth. We used to have pictures. I'm sure my parents still have it. And then, during that time, I felt a strong need, like a strong desire to pray for him. Okay? But I was also scared. Something was holding me back. I just felt the need, like, pray for him. And I was really holding myself because the thing is, I always think that sometimes as Christians, we know that Jesus can heal us, Jesus can do this for us, but we don't believe that he will actually do it. Like, the faith is not there. And so I was worried. I ignored it. The thought comes, like, call your nephew, pray for him. And then I just leave it. I left it for a long time. And then I didn't want to pray for him and then nothing happens, and then I think I was thinking about my soul instead of thinking about the God that was calling me to actually pray for my nephew. I was just thinking about myself, that what if I pray and it doesn't happen? Well, what if you pray and it doesn't happen? If it doesn't happen, it is not you. You pray to God to heal someone. It is God who is going to heal the person or not heal. And so you just leave it in the hands of God. And so I waited until the last day when I was leaving Ghana to China. I fetched a bottle of water and then I prayed over it. Well, I called my nephew and I asked him, well, they say this is a permanent scar and you have to go to the dentist for them to fill it up or something like that. I want to pray for you. Do you believe Jesus can heal you? He said yes. And so I prayed over the water and I told him, I gave the water to him. I told him, every morning when you wake up, just pray over the water again and ask Jesus to heal you and drink the water. After I did that, I felt a lot of peace because I had been ignoring this for a long time, and then I left China. Not long after, I had a call from my dad telling me, Essie, the prayer has worked. Joe's teeth that was broken, crooked teeth, right, had started growing. It had started growing and it grew. It was crooked though, like it was crooked. It grew until it became perfect. Like, the thing was crooked though. Crooked. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. It wasn't even uniform. It didn't even break like this, like uniformly. It was a crooked break. It was very crooked. And then the teeth started growing. Two of them, they started growing. And then it became leveled. Like, it was smoothened. The teeth was smoothened, like the bottom part was smoothened, like they have smoothened it, like all the gaps were filled and smoothened without a doctor or a dentist. And they were shocked. My dad said when the teeth started growing, he was amazed, like he wanted to see how the whole thing was going to end because it was crooked, right? And then the thing about the new tip that God gave to him was that it was even nicer than the old ones, because the old ones were very protruded, like So I remember my sister had said before that when he was old, she would take him to a dentist for them to fix it for him, okay? So if you were a frequent watcher of Emmanuel TV, you would know that three things that the Prophet TV Joshua always talked about were love, number one. Love. You always talk about love. And it came with giving and forgiveness. How to give, how to give, how to forgive. And one thing he also always spoke about was faith. Jesus Christ. Having faith in Jesus Christ. I will be a very big liar if I tell you that Emmanuel TV hasn't helped me. It's helped to build my faith in Jesus Christ. It was through Emmanuel TV that I learned how to develop a personal relationship to God, to appreciate God's love for me, and to enjoy God's love for me. Like, there were a lot of people used to say TB Joshua was not even qualified to be a prophet or a teacher of the word of God because he never had any training from like a mentor. Like, he just started on his own when he was young. Like, he never had any training. Like, maybe some have received training from Idahosa, some have done this. It's good to be taught by a mentor, to go to a Bible school. It's all there. Like, God has different ways of teaching everyone. People can be taught by the Holy Spirit directly. And I think that is what we should all be yearning for. Not depending on a pastor or a prophet or on a school or whatever. All that our provisions God has made for us. God made all those provisions for us. But the ultimate one is to develop your personal relationship with God. Stop judging. I mean, to see someone, one thing I also learned from TB Joshua is to not judge too quickly things that I don't understand. I mean, if you see someone doing this, doing that, don't just go straight to the point to judge. Even in the Bible, God says, allow them all to grow. At the time of harvesting, he will decide if this is fake or not.
What is forgiveness? You have meaning for your forgiveness, but what my Bible made me to understand, when you read your Bible from Genesis to Revelation, forgiveness means that God looks at you as if you had never sinned. When you receive his forgiveness, you are blameless before him. Let him put it in that way. You are what? That is, when you receive his forgiveness, you are blameless before him. God's forgiveness does not sweep your sin under the carpet. Instead, he completely washes them away. Forgive even those who mocked and killed him. We should be more concerned about our offenders and their relationship with God, and less about not seeing our own grudges and self-pity, that is ill will